All the great speeches this week, or many of them, have had a personal touch. So I've decided to add that last minute to my speech. And so I want to give you three pieces of trivia about myself. I am born in Als, a little Danish island. And last time I was here in South Africa, it was going to, I went via South Africa to pay my lobola. And the third thing I want to add is I played on Dover College rugby team. And that's not the reason that I'm wearing this rugby t-shirt. The reason that I'm wearing this, the Springboks, is because the last meeting I had with Ravi in Copenhagen, he insisted should take place in the only South African pub in Copenhagen, and apparently they were playing a match between the Springboks and the Aussies. The Springboks won, and much of the meeting was not really about much else than rugby. So this is my way of saying thank you to Ravi and to Ravi's team, Matthew, Lauren, and everyone. So basically that's the trivia that you're gonna get. And I was probably presented here primarily because of the bicycles, but what I'm gonna speak about today does not just involve me, but also two other guys. So this is supposed to be a KI, that stands for Key, which is Kilo, and it's a guy, Lars Larsen, who has that company. And B is the next one, stands for Big. It's that's a guy, Bjarke Engels, who has that company. And the last one is me. So that's a new venture, and it's about product design. And I'm very happy to continue on the path of Darwin. And what happened was, when we had started, Bjarke made a fantastic TED Talk. I didn't know at that point it was fantastic, because I didn't really feel like watching it, because I saw him every day anyway at the office. So I was still convinced to go ahead and watch it, and this is roughly what I saw. And here you've got Bjarke's way, he's an architect, way of approaching evolution. I think it's closer to what Lamarck thinks about evolution than what Darwin thinks about evolution, but that doesn't matter so much. So that's his version of the Spanish stairs in Rome. And so at our office, we keep all of these old things we have made and let them get new offspring. And at the same time, I was launching a book in Denmark, and I was talking to some think tank about that book before it was launched, and I was talking about how design was idea-driven. And much to my annoyment, they wanted me to explain what I meant by ideas, whether those were platonic or, you know, some other kind of definition. I had studied philosophy, and it was certainly not a path I was thrilled of going down. But anyway, I thought they're probably right. I have to think about what is an idea. So the theoretician that I landed on is this guy Dawkins, another evolutionary theorist, theoretician, or however you say that. He has this idea that evolution does not only happen in our animal kingdom, because there are some things that happen in evolution that we go around and do that could not be explained by evolutionary theory if it was only about improving our gene pool. So, for instance, going into a building and blowing up yourself and the rest of the building does not make sense in terms of propagating your genes. So he thought there must be another order, and The thing he then he said, there's something called memes, and so that is a mixture of mimesis, which is to copy, and genes. So he created this neologism, and the idea is that that you can boil evolution down even further than Ben Fry did, and you can actually boil it down to three words, and that one is that there has to be variation, and the second is that there has to be replication, and the third, some selection. So to explain what I mean by that, then, so for instance, two types of different dances that I'm not going to perform would be variation. So breakdance and polka are two different types of dances, and if you can copy them, which you can, then they can be replicated. So that's that takes care of the second. And the third is you select one of them. And so the one that gets selected, like let's say polka is not so much on the high streets in Manhattan. So a lot of people have selected breakdance instead. And that's kind of the idea you propagate. And that goes for products. As well, and so the idea is that actually you are just a body holding these ideas, and people copy those ideas if they're strong ideas, not because of some rationale. So I'm going to go through a few themes that we have at KiBiSi. This theme is a theme that's particularly dear to me, mobility, because of the bicycles. And so to illustrate my point here, this is the world's fastest bicycle. So it's a recumbent bike, and it rides within HPVs, human-powered vehicles. You have a discipline called the 200-meter sprint. You can start whenever you want, and you just go faster and faster until you hit those specific 200 meters where your average speed is measured. And this one has the world record of 130 kilometers an hour. And it is only muscles. So if, you know, and actually the riders riding them are not particularly good riders because there is no money in this. So they are not the, yeah. And what decided the, you know, the evolution of the bike is not some kind of rational, but basically what are, what is a strong idea and another kind of coincidence in the world. Actually, this coincidence was caused by some French guys in UCI in, I think, 1934, and all the recumbent bikes, that's the low riding bikes like these ones, were winning all of the races. Back then, racing in a velodrome was like Formula One today, it was like the speed sport, and so there was a lot of money involved, and they just decided this is not a bike. So other mechanisms drive us, and so I want to take as a point of departure Biomega that I founded, and I founded it because I was demonstrating, and I was like a kind of an activist, you know, I was shouting, cars get out of the city, and a lot of other people were shouting the same, but it didn't really have an impact, and in general, people do not admire extremists. So I found that I had to, find another way of getting around it. And of course, you know, there are some really severe issues with cars in the city. I mean, yeah, you can see those mentioned on the screen. So yeah, of course, there's the noise part also, and we're actually destroying our planet not just because of cars. There's a host of other issues, but this is one little subject that you can do in order to change things for the better. So there are a lot of issues that people die now more, you know, because of diabetes, and you have a bigger chance of doing so in a car. But it's a little bit like smoking. You know, it's not because you say that you're going to get fat in a car that people will stop using a car. So I have these statistics here because they are ridiculous. That, you know, it's a this is how we commute. One is an American statistic, the other an Australian, and it's just bikes are just not mentioned as solution to this problem. So, what is the actual problem? The actual problem is that in the next 40 years, over 3 billion people will move into cities. So, so that's roughly the amount of people living in cities today. So, so all of the Joburgs and the Mexico City, the Tokyos, New Delhis, all of these, we will have to rebuild those in the next 40 years. And so even if we are not ideological about being environmental and stuff like that, it is just not possible to use the solutions we have today in cities. So we need to find new solutions, and we are finding new solutions, but this takes time. And so we have one solution that's been around us for well over 100 years that actually can solve part of the problem of getting around in the city. So, that was kind of my angle of attack when I went in to the bike business, and I was thinking, so how can I make people choose bikes over cars? And the way I approached it was I wanted to go a hedonistic route, and when people say design, well, as we've heard many times this week, then it is not necessarily critical to them. But I can tell you, design is part of communicating who we are, and also it's such a strong self-expression that's part of our rituals when we get a mate, that it's much more important to us than most other things. And what I mean by that is that design is a little bit like these birds dancing these dances in order to attract the opposite sex, and it addresses two fundamental fears that we all have, and so everyone is afraid of not being loved, and everyone is afraid of not being adequate, and there is simply no one not afraid of these two things, and design is a cure to some of that. Expressing who you are is alleviate some of that. And so if we have a massive problem in 40 years or even a more massive problem in 100 years, does not really ring a bell to people compared to you're going to have a hard time getting offspring. So, yeah. So this to me is not about seeing how can we make a great car or how can we make a great bicycle. This is about how can we see these as two different formats in a format war. So every time you see a new bike on the street, if it just takes the place of another bike, it does not really matter because you have the same amount of green in your environment or the same amount of CO2 emission that's in your environment. It's the moment you have someone buying a bicycle instead of a car that it starts to matter. So you've got to look at the mechanisms that drive format change. And so those are not the functionalistic ones that people are looking at today. Today what people are doing is building a lot of bike lanes and looking at how can we get practical about this. Well, bikes have been more practical than cars in cities since the beginning. They are much, much faster. My grandmother can get around faster than a Formula One on her bicycle. It's much, much cheaper, much healthier. I mean, if you look at the sum of it, I know some would debate this, and I'm not going to go through all of the details because you're going to get bored, but they are practically superior. And even if they were as practical, or not more practical, but roughly as practical as cars, it could not explain why 99% of all capitals are dominated by cars and not bikes. So you've got to look at what makes Microsoft win over Linux, or in this case, what does iPod do to win over Sony, or, you know, there are tons of format wars we can take as an example. So I'm going to tell you just on an anecdotal basis what I did. So I started Biomega, and the first design, I thought, okay, I got to get a great designer to do this. And so I got hold of Mark Newson, who's an Australian designer, and probably many of you know who he is. And yeah, so he's a fantastic designer. He decided to make things very, very complicated. And so we did it in superplastically formed aluminum. It's a superplastically formed sheet that you can see there that you stamp out. It will actually, you suck it out. It takes 45 minutes, so it's not an instant process. And then you CNC it out. And I went up to Birmingham in England, where I found two guys that had this place called Servant Engineering. And what they did was all sorts of weird things. So they were involved in building a fusion reactor, and also been involved in building the world's fastest car that you have there, that broke the sound barrier on Earth. And I thought I'd better go and see what they did, and not tell that I would come, so I could see if they were serious people or not. So I barged in their offices in the middle of a conversation they had with Charles Morgan. They make these old Morgan cars, a little bit to their annoyance, but it turns out that I was the asshole and they were very, very nice, and showed me around the whole facility while Charles Morgan had to wait. The next bike I did was with Ross Lovegrove. And it was made in bamboo. What these two bikes had in common was that they were bonded, and it was actually the bonding part of it that was very, very difficult. So when you see a Tour de France at the sprint, you will see this part of the bike do like a kind of a 3D 8. And that means there's a lot of forces, a lot of dynamic forces that go into the bike. People had bonded plenty of easy things like cars and planes at that point, but not bicycles. And the reason that I say that planes, for instance, are easy to bond is that the wings, they don't do like this. They just sit like this, and they're static, like a chair. It's very easy to deal with static forces compared to dynamic forces. So, if an example of what static is versus dynamic, if you go out here in the street and put the biggest male elephant from Angola and just ask it to stand there, nothing will happen. If you give your kid a hammer, and then the pavement will be destroyed within very few minutes. So the dynamic forces are just a whole different nature, and we were actually the first one to bond such a difficult area. So I had some design principles on how I would outcompete cars in the city. I haven't gotten there yet, but we will get there. I looked at, what is the reason that people buy a car in a city? And it is not a practical function. It does not make sense, for instance, to ride a Ferrari or a Range Rover or such car in a city. So it's not because it's super practical, it's something else. It's because I believe you express something about yourself. So if prior to coming on stage, I had been presented as the guy who owns a Rolls-Royce, or the guy who owns a Fiat, or the guy who owns a Ford, or, you know, name any car brand, you would have a clear mental picture of at least who I want you to think I am. And if you had been told, oh, the guy, he has a Giant bike, or Cannondale, or Trek, or just about any bicycle around, it would not have meant anything in particular other that you have been informed that the guy has some technical contraption as well. So therefore, I thought this expressiveness you got to build in to the bikes, and that's the visibility part. And the drivability part is sounds maybe pretty simple. It's kind of being user friendly, and what I mean by that is if you take how bicycles are thought and transplant that onto cars, people would just not buy them. So you would never accept to buy a car that had 2 stick shifts and you had 30 combination gears, or to go out and unlock the bike on the wheel or adjust the suspension there, or have a 4 pedal, 1 for each brake. I mean, there are like a host of things you just would not put up with. So drivability is a very important part. I think the most important part is the integration. So whenever you see a car, you say, oh, there is one car, you know, you see that as one object, but actually there is more than 20,000 objects. It takes more than 20,000 objects to form a car. So there are plenty of little screws and bolts and nuts and parts in a car, and yet you see one thing. When you look at a bike, well, often people see much more than one thing. They will see, oh, nice saddle, nice pair of brakes, I like the gears. They will start seeing a puzzle in front of them. And there are also more than one part on a bike, but they are less than 400. So how can how come a bicycle is seen as a puzzle and a car just seen as one object? So and I think that to integrate things into one whole is what makes that the difference. So if I should, well, I'll probably show you on the pictures to show you how we've done that. And then the durability is a very simple thing. It just got to last longer than what they do today. So during this conference, we've been very focused on everything that's visual. But the visual aspect is just one out of 5 senses, and we as designers should be able to embrace them all. One of the things I also emulated from the design industry was this, that when a car smells of new car, it does not do so because a new car smells like that, but because someone has an aerosol that says new car that they spray into the car. And so I went ahead and did my take on how a new bike should smell. And I'm going to let you smell that while... there's a movie of the bikes that runs. I don't have samples enough for everyone, so please pass them around, but they will be passed to you during this movie here. So these bikes are made to live a very long time. And I think one of the prerequisites to have a long product life is that you still want to look at it in many years. It sounds a little bit obvious, but I can assure you there are so many things that are getting thrown out that could last much, much longer. It has a very long life cycle, but it doesn't matter to make quality if it doesn't have that aesthetic sustainability that will make it make you keep it around. So most tube TVs today, actually, or you know, the classic tube TV, I almost don't see them back in Denmark where I'm from anymore. Actually, they have a better picture, and you know, they work fine. But we kind of moved on in terms of aesthetic taste. So I won't spend much too long. That is the original bike that Mark designed. The idea of this super plastically formed was that it was a marine type of aluminum. All the aluminum bikes came from California. California has great weather like here. We don't in Denmark. There's a lot of salt. And so it was an aluminum bike that could actually last. I think I like this bike because I designed it myself. And this is the Copenhagen bike. And here you can kind of see what I mean by integration. So even the transmission is integrated in the shaft. The brakes are integrated. The cables are integrated. That, as much as I could so far do, have been integrated in this bike. This is kind of a fun bike. It has small fat wheels that bounce like this. And then it took those jumbo tubes that you knew from California and brought them on a European typology. This one, actually originally designed it for Puma, but we also carried it in our own line. And that cable there, you can open up and use as a lock. And if you break the lock, you break the entire structure of the bike. So you can vandalize it, but you can't steal it. So here's the bamboo that I mentioned. This is one of the latest bikes. This is Ross Lovegrove who designed that bike. It's a monocoque carbon fiber bike with the shaft also. And this is the one here that I designed with KiBiSi. And so in this one, the special thing, well, for one, it has this belt drive, but another thing is that the mudguard here in front is integrated. Via KiBiSi and also Biomega, we started working with Puma. This is the first Puma bike that I showed also in the in the other portfolio, in the Biomega portfolio. So the idea with Puma was also this of making lifestyle for the cities. But whereas Biomega is like very has a very classic design approach and very niche that it kind of speaks to a design clientele. And Puma is a much broader brand that's about having fun, and it's not necessarily, you don't necessarily need to be rich to buy them. And so it's another more playful approach to it. And they have a little bit of a fashion tradition, so we can change colors, whereas in the Biomega range, we stay consistent over the years. A little bit like they also do in the car industry, by the way, where you have a Golf and you have a second generation Golf and third generation Golf, the Volkswagen. I don't know if you have it here, so it's a classic approach in the car industry that we use for Biomega, whereas here we're more fashion oriented. So we took again the urban needs, and here in this case we've played around with transportation a lot. It can also fold like the other one. It doesn't get super small. It's just in order for you to get into an elevator or subway, your apartment with it. The handlebar is all like the what do we call it? The transportational device in the front is integrated in with the handlebars. And so that theme we kind of brought out. And here it's a very different type of design also in the sense that it's line design, so a little bit like some, like some car companies have, like Porsche or whatever. If you see a Porsche, you know it's a Porsche. If you see an Audi, you know it's an Audi. And in this case, we did the same. We had this octagonal tube that goes throughout the whole line so people can recognize it even if you scrape off the logo. So this is a fixie type bike that has flip-flop, means you can have it either fixed gear or single speed. And here again, you see the transportational theme. And all of these bikes, by the way, have names of Atlantic islands, because what we've been doing for them is we have taken American typologies, bicycle typologies. They're very different, so they have beach cruisers, for instance, that we don't traditionally have in Europe, and we have, let's say, city bikes, and so we've merged these typologies to form new typologies. I think a speech that I thought would be about KiBiSi has now become about Biomega. But anyway, I think I'm out of time, right? So I'll leave it with that.